Good morning and welcome to the 2018 April Commencement. Let us begin this celebration with a word of prayer. O Lord, as you caused the sun to rise this morning in the east, so you have caused this college to rise in the east on the coastal plain of North Carolina. Today we are thankful for motivated students, thankful for supportive families and friends, thankful for dedicated faculty and staff, thankful for generous donors, but most of all, we are thankful for your grace. Lord, the fountain beyond us reminds us of your grace, which flows continuously like a fountain. Though we have been blessed to drink from the fountain of knowledge, may we ever be humble as we celebrate today, yet full of the wisdom and courage that come with Christian education. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. We will have a moment of silence at this time, please. Join me. This moment of silence was for Justin Gordon, who was a student here from August 2014 until he passed away on November 20th, 2017. Justin was studying business management. We have this plaque in his memory, and it will be given to his family at the end of the ceremony today. You may be seated.
Welcome, everyone. What a glorious day. If you were a service member servicing our great country, please stand. In the audience, please stand. Let's have a round of applause, please. Now, would everyone stand as we present our colors by the North Carolina Wesleyan ROTC, and graduate Leticia Jones will be singing a Star Spangled Banner for us. Please join in.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof star-spangled banner, yeah, wave. Oh, the land of the free and the home of the brave.
You may be seated. Our guest speaker, Jimmy Jones, was born in Magnolia, North Carolina, and his family moved to New Bern after the end of the war. Mr. Jones graduated from Wofford College in South Carolina with a BA in economics. He began his career in lumber sales at Wells Oats Lumber Company. Then in 1968, he began working at his father's lumber company, J.E. Jones Lumber. After his father passed away in 1989, he became president of the company. Mr. Jones is a member of Garber United Methodist Church. He has been involved at his church and with the Boy Scouts. He served on many other boards, clubs, and associations. In October 2017, Mr. Jones was elected to the North Carolina Wesleyan College Board of Trustees. He is married to Patricia and has 5 children, 9 grandchildren, and 5 great-grandchildren. Would you welcome Jimmy Jones to the podium, please?
Thank you, Dr. Drum, and thank you, class of 2018, for allowing me to be here with you today. I'm sure that thanks to Dr. Drum, you know more about me now than you ever wanted to learn, except for one thing, and I can see it in your faces. You're wondering, what is that old guy from New Bern got to say to us? Well, you need to know first that we do have something in common. I have sat where you sit, not here, not literally, 52 years ago, Spartanburg, South Carolina, Wofford College. So what I'm here for today, for one reason, is to tell you a story. Now, all of my friends and family and Sunday school class back in New Bern know that I do love to tell a story. In fact, they've heard the same stories so many times that they have taken to number them. So that when I start to tell a story, somebody will say, oh, that's number 23. And then they laugh and I go on. There's a second reason that I'm here today too, and I'll tell you that later. But now I want you to know that I was blessed to grow up in a family with parents that love the Lord. They insisted that my brothers and I always went every Sunday to Sunday school and to worship. We prayed every day. We read the Bible every day. And about that time, as I was growing up, I liked also to play Billy Graham. My best friend Skip and my brother Mike and I used to go to the movies quite often in New Bern, and we'd come back home and we would play the movie, you know. If it was a Western, we played cowboys. If it was a gangster movie, we played cops and robbers. Well, about that same time, I loved watching Billy Graham on television. I used to sit on the floor in front of that huge cabinet that had a screen about the size of a dinner plate. But I listened to Billy Graham. And when he finished, I would grab Skip and Mike and take them in my bedroom and I would play Billy Graham. I got out my music stand from school, used it as a pulpit, and I preached to them. I even took my little Bible and held it in my left hand wide open just like Billy. As a teenager, I was president of the youth fellowship. We called it MYF back then. And I enjoyed everything about the church. I tell you these things so you'll understand that from my childhood all through high school, I knew that I wanted to go to college and prepare myself to be a Methodist preacher. And so when I entered Wofford College in 1962 with a pre-ministerial curriculum, nobody at home was surprised. Nobody at school, nobody at church, none of my family were surprised that I was going to be a Methodist preacher. I never could remember a singular moment that I would say, that's when I was saved. It concerned me at one time, and I talked to my pastor about it, and he said, well, are you saved? And I said, yes. He said, well, that's all that matters. It doesn't matter where or when. It just matters that. But during my first year at Wofford, some of my classmates and even my roommate who did go on to seminary after graduation, but they would ask me, how do you know that you're called to be a preacher? Well, I really didn't know. And I began to question that. And then I asked myself, have you really been called for this, or are you just trying to do what everybody else thinks you should do? At one point, I thought, well, maybe it's not the pulpit ministry that I'm called to. Maybe it's the music talent that the Lord has gifted me. And so I took some music courses and at Converse College, which credited at Wofford. All this time, my father could only encourage me to do whatever I did the best that I could. Never said anything about going in the lumber business. But at the same time, he counseled me that it might be a good idea and practical to take a business course every now and then when you have a chance as an elective that would serve you all through your life. And so, bookkeeping led to accounting, led to economics, led to marketing, and I was absolutely fascinated. So, I graduated Wofford with that degree in economics, came back, went to work in the lumber business. When my father died in 1989, and I became president of our family business, I was the same age he was when he started the company in 1968. And all those years that I had working with him, I learned how important it was to run a business with honor and integrity. I also learned that there's nothing wrong with being transparent with your faith. And I was. And in running the business, I had an opportunity to go to different association meetings and conventions, and finally I got elected to some boards and served in those capacities. And when I was president of the Hardwood Manufacturing Association, I instigated the practice of saying prayer at mealtime. They'd never done that before. And I also opened every board of directors meeting with a prayer. When I finished my term as president, they made me chaplain for life. I said, you know, I appreciate that, but I'd really like to be a cardinal instead of just a chaplain. He said, why do you want to be a cardinal? I said, so I could wear those red shoes. So sure enough, they changed the bylaws. They made me cardinal of the HMA. And guess what? They presented me with a pair of red shoes. Ferragamos, by the way. And I still wear them when I go to the convention. It also gave me rare opportunities to travel around the world, especially into Asia, as where we ship a lot of our lumber. And I've actually had the opportunity to sit down and talk about Jesus to non-Christians in non-Christian countries, in countries where we really shouldn't have been having those conversations. Now, there's one thing we don't have in common, and that's my extensive hindsight. You might catch up to me someday, but I'm way ahead of you now. And I want to share with you briefly how this hindsight has taught me about God's calling. But first, I feel another story coming on. This one's number 34. Back in the early 70s, the sanctuary of our church was Cedar Shake. It was very pretty, but a couple of woodpeckers found out about it. And one day, our pastor was preaching a sermon similar to my address about God's calling. Now, Pastor Bill was, I would not be ashamed to say, overly dramatic in his preaching. In fact, we knew when something big was coming up when he leaned over the pulpit and grabbed the lapels of his robe. So this day, sure enough, he leaned over, grabbed the lapels and said, and remember, when God calls, you have to listen. You have to be quiet and listen. There was the woodpecker. The congregation gasped. You know what we all thought. But then laughter, and then everybody laughed, and the preacher couldn't stop laughing, so he finally said amen, and we sang the final hymn. Now back to the real story about God's calling. Oz Guinness explains it far better than I can in his book, aptly titled, The Calling. And he defines the notion of calling this way. Calling is the truth that God calls us to himself so that decisively everything we are is lived out as a response to his call. Let me read that to you again. Calling is the truth that God calls us to himself. And then he goes on to say that in the New Testament, there's a whole new concept of calling. Because now we learn and we know that God calls us to him as followers of Jesus Christ. And he says it's almost a synonym of salvation. Now you can imagine how that affected me when I used to worry about not knowing when and where. Now I know. It was when God called me and I responded. He makes a distinction between the primary call and the secondary call. Our primary calling, he writes, as followers of Christ, is by him, to him, and for him. First and foremost, we are called to someone. That would be God. Then he says our secondary calling is our answer to God's summons. They are really callings, not just calling. So we can say that we are called to respond by following a particular course. But we must always be sure that the primary calling leads to a secondary calling. A final quote from the call: neither work nor career can be fully satisfying without a deeper sense of calling. But calling itself is empty and indistinguishable from work unless there is someone who calls. I promise to tell you the second reason that I'm here today. Anybody got it? Yeah, I was called. So here I am. I would leave you with this benediction. May God's blessings go with you, each and every one. And may through his grace, you be a blessing to others. Amen.
Thank you, Jimmy. Good morning. It is my great pleasure to welcome everyone to this community celebration, which honors a group of promising men and women who, through intelligence, discipline, and hard work, have earned degrees from North Carolina Wesleyan College. This is indeed a joyous occasion, a time when we celebrate learning and academic achievement. It is also a time when we recall once again that few worthwhile things are achieved without the help and support of others. Today, we honor our graduates through a ceremony, elements of which stretch back through the centuries to medieval Europe. The academic robes, the caps, the gowns denote that each of you have joined a long and proud tradition. It is important to note on this occasion that these degrees are provided by an institution which seeks not only to dispense knowledge and develop the habits for lifelong learning, but also expects its graduates to be responsible citizens, contributors to the common good, men and women who care about others. As we celebrate together, we acknowledge the obligations all of us have to help to bring about a better world. We're finishing a semester today that saw record enrollment in both the Day and Aspire programs. We are 4 years into a 12-year plan to take us to 2,000 students that the founders envisioned back in October of 1956 when the college started. Personally, I'll always have a great attachment to this class as we started the same year. I have really enjoyed getting to know these students. Thank you for a lot of special memories. And thank you for all that helped make this one of the best semesters ever. Now, it is my pleasure and honor to introduce to you our 2018 commencement speaker, Ms. Janice Bryant Howroyd. Businesswoman, entrepreneur, educator, author, mentor, and presidential special appointee, Janice Bryant Howroyd is the founder and chief executive officer of the Act One Group, a leading global corporation providing customized, cutting-edge workforce solutions in the human resource industry. The Act One Group is a multi-billion dollar award-winning international talent and talent technology enterprise with multiple divisions that service unique areas of employment and provide talent management solutions. The Act One Group was founded by Janice in 1978 and now operates in 22 different countries and offers services via Apple One Staffing, A-Check Global, Act One Government, and Agile One. Janice has significantly invested in creating the industry's most advanced technology and talent platforms, serving ever-changing business needs across many different industries. Her vision as an industry leader is fostering connectivity between these sectors, giving competitive advantage to clients, and her understanding of global market demographics and trends has made her a highly sought-after ambassador, speaker, and commentator on global business issues. Janice was featured in May of 2017 issue of Forbes magazines as one of America's richest self-made women. In 2014, Ms. Bryant Howroyd was recognized by Black Enterprise as the first woman to own and operate a $1 billion company. Ms. Howroyd was BET's first ever Honors Entrepreneur of the Year and also received the Black Enterprise Business of the Year Award. In 2017, CNBC noted her fourth of 14 black women who changed business and finance, placing her above Oprah Winfrey and Michelle Obama. Forbes also recently named her as one of 2017's America's Self-Made Women, and Ebony Magazine placed her on their 2017 100 Most Powerful and Influential Black Americans. Recognized by both past and presidential administration, Janice was appointed and continues to serve as a U.S. Ambassador to the Department of Energy's Minorities and Energy U.S. International Trade Advisory Commission Board. That's a mouthful. Janice also received an appointment to the Board of Advisors for the White House Initiative on Historically Black Colleges and Universities. Most recently, Janice was appointed to the Chairman Powell's Advisory Committee on Diversity and Digital Empowerment for the Federal Communications Commission. She serves on boards of organizations that includes Women's Business Enterprise National Council, National Minority Supplier Development Council, and the LA National Urban League. Janice has traveled to over 50 countries promoting education and the powerful impact it has on communities both domestically and globally. Through scholarship funding and personal service supporting universities like Harvard's Women's Leadership Board of the Kennedy School of Government, University of Southern California, California State University San Bernardino, and her own alma mater, North Carolina A&T University. As a Board of Trustee member at North Carolina A&T State University, she supported their success in graduating the nation's largest number of African-American engineers. Likewise, Ms. Bryant Howroyd has been a driving force advocating for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics education as one of the greatest equalizers in the 21st century. Her accomplishments, both personal and professional, are inspired by a deep faith and love for her family. She says one cannot effectively lead without passionately serving. Her professional mantra is never compromise who you are personally to become who you wish to become professionally. Now, I say all that, and I'll summarize it to say this is a big deal. We have a small town girl from Tarboro, North Carolina, about 20 miles east, who went to LA and it became a big deal. And she's back home today. So welcome home. Thank you for coming. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Janice Bryant Howroyd.
Greetings. That's a whole lot about me, but this is about you. I understand that in this audience today, diplomas will be bestowed upon people from around the world. Talk about a small town, right? I'm going to call out some states and some countries. Your work is not yet complete. You've got two more things to do before you receive your diplomas. One is now. As I call out the states and countries, I'd like each of you who represent from those states and or countries to stand, shield your eyes, and look that way. Alabama, Arkansas, Washington, D.C., Delaware, Florida, Iowa, Idaho, Illinois, Maryland, Pennsylvania, North Carolina, Virginia, Argentina, Australia, Brazil, Japan, Mexico, Sweden, United Kingdom, and Venezuela. Now, as you stand, I want you to look at the people who are in front of you. You're going to receive some tremendous applause moments after I finish talking with you. But right now, I'd love you to honor the folks who are here for you with your own applause. As you turn around to sit, I want you to close your eyes. Trust me, just close your eyes. This university, this college, has taught you to open your eyes to all sorts of opportunities of learning and possibility. In this moment, I want you to close your eyes in reflection on those. You see, don't go to sleep if you stayed up partying last night. You see, it was 50 years ago that I first stepped on this campus. This campus was very different then. Dr. Dewey Clark had not yet brought what some would say his magic to the university. I would say his own special blessing to the university. When I stepped on this campus, 50 years ago was the first time I touched the hand of a white person who held me back with warmth and support. Is it any surprise that this college is doing that same thing now for those of you who've come from so many places to learn in the community of this school? I came to this school as a Project Upward Bound student. And North Carolina Wesleyan in Rocky Mount welcomed me with arms and with teachings that have been so important to me as I've journeyed my career. Keep your eyes closed. I want you to hear what I have to say. You see, Dr. Dewey said I went to North Carolina A&T State University. Aggie Pride. What does A&T, a state-supported school, and Wesleyan have in common? These two schools have much in common, but for me, the biggest thing they have in common is that they teach us to live as fully as our imagination can take us. You see, students, the world really is as big as you can imagine it. And that's what I want to talk with you about right now. Keep your eyes closed and raise your hands if you've ever heard of a song by John Lennon called Imagine. Wow. I'm believing many of you are millennials and you've heard of it. The first time I heard that song, I was sitting on a stoop, yes, the stoop, in front of our home in Tarboro, North Carolina. John Lennon sang to the world, asking us to imagine no heaven, no hell. He asked us to imagine people living for today in peace, no reasons to kill or die. He even asked us to imagine what it would be like without religion. He said, you might call him a dreamer, but he asked us to join him in that dream. I will tell you that I learned one thing profoundly. As we talk about all of you students who are coming from so many states, so many countries, and you're on a campus that has faith as its foundation, here's the thing I've learned in my journey. Religion is our search for God. Faith is our relationship with God. I've traveled so many countries, as Dr. Dewey shared with you, and the one thing I know is that people of all religions share one faith when we honor a creator. As you leave this campus, I'm asking you to keep that in mind. Now, here's something that you need to do before you open your eyes. I want you just to imagine what your thoughts about your future were when you first stepped feet on this campus. And I want you to imagine all the people who you just stood up and applauded, and those who aren't here, who deserve your applause, what their thoughts were for you. And I want you to carry that into the conversation we're about to have as you open your eyes now and share with me your respect for the tremendous, tremendous meaning of today. You see, I was born in Tarboro, North Carolina, as Dr. Dewey said, just a few minutes away from here. At the time I was born, that town was about 12,000 people, and about 5,000 of them were in the community that I lived in. We were a segregated community back then, and I used television to show me what the world could look like beyond where we were at that time. Have any of you ever heard of a TV show called Julia? Well, I want you to Google it. Julia was a TV show, and it had as its star Nolan Lloyd, who was a doctor, and a beautiful, beautiful Diane Carroll, who was a nurse. And that nurse ran that doctor's life. She was black. She was lovely, and she was the first African-American woman I saw who had on a white dress and wasn't a maid. She showed me that I could imagine a world bigger than the community I was from. TV showed me Julia, but Mom and Dad showed me the world from an academic perspective. The school that I attended didn't have lots of encyclopedias and other textbooks that I could learn from, but we had dedicated teachers. And I remember my mom saving money and buying an encyclopedia set dollar by dollar. How many of you have even seen an encyclopedia? That's amazing because only half of you have seen them, but all of you are graduating today. That's the testimony of imagination. When someone can imagine a technology that allows us to have learning at our fingertips, books online, some of you will go on to invent opportunities for new ways of learning. But you know, Mom and Dad taught us something that wasn't in the books. They taught us about the A's of life. I want to get real with you. Mom and Dad taught 11 children that wherever we went in life, it was not going to be our aptitude alone that would get us there. It would fundamentally and dynamically be about our attitude. Dad encouraged us as kids to have our arguments during the day. He loved a healthy debate. But he told us at night when we go to bed, we all had to be in one accord. There was no room in our home for disrespect of each other. And if we couldn't solve a problem before we went to bed, it was more about our attitude than our aptitude, because Mom didn't raise any dumb kids. Now, we've debated that amongst ourselves, whether or not that was true. But I can't tell you which ones I thought were dumb, because some of them are in the audience today. What I can tell you is that when people come together, we come together around all things, all religions, customs. We come together around the imagination of what the world can be and how it can be better from our presence in it. And everything you've learned up till now on this campus is going to support you dynamically, but you're going to have to know something that this campus, I pray, outside of the classroom has taught you. And that's about the respect you can have for each other in the world as you go out into a broader community than you've ever known before. 22 countries I operate in. Each one of them are the manifestation of an imagination of possibility and opportunity. Dr. Jimmy Jones talked about watching television and waiting and listening hungrily to what Dr. Billy Graham taught him. My experience was not so different from that. I waited hungrily for magazines. Yeah, we had print back then. Magazines like Essence, Ebony. And how many of you in the audience, and this might be a lot of black hands raising, remember a magazine called Jet Magazine? I love Jet Magazine. Jet Magazine taught me about Dr. Martin Luther King. Taught me that we could seek to achieve, to change, and to grow without the argument and the misunderstanding that hostility can offer. And so you're looking at somebody here who, when Dr. Dewey is up here telling you about me, I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, I want to meet her too. What a woman. The truth is, I'm only the imagination that the people who cared for me instilled in me that allowed me to imagine for myself. And that's why it was so important for me to ask you to stand today and look at the people here who are supporting you and their imagination for you, what they imagined for you in a world that really needs you. The biggest question you can ever ask yourself is not why am I here, but how am I here? How do you leave this campus and go into each endeavor you will seek to achieve? Dr. Dewey's sister Denise asked me a question this morning. She said, Janice, when people introduce you and they talk about all the things you've achieved, how does it make you feel? And I share with Denise what I just said to you. Sometimes they share so much stuff that I think, yeah, I really want to meet her. I want to know what she's about, literally and figuratively. But the larger moments for me are when I hear these things, it makes me feel gratitude. Gratitude that I live in a world, that I came from a place that, yes, allowed me to imagine a world that would be bigger than anything that little nappy-headed colored girl in Tarboro, North Carolina had ever seen. And some of you have those opportunities in front of you manifesting at this moment. Others of you have those opportunities manifesting for you in ways you don't yet see. Please take everything you've learned on this campus. Take it forward with you into a world and share it, because the world is hungry and in need of the principled teachings that you've had offered to you. You see, I have an executive right now who's going through a lot of things in his life. And what he's going through can very, very well be a teaching for you in this moment as I ask you to keep imagining what the world can be like, what the difference you can make in the world, not just what the world can make as a difference for you. And it is cooperative. This executive had his world turned upside down in a moment of a week, so dynamically so, that he had to make life decisions that impacted him, his family, and all of the people he was leading. And he's had to do that with grace and with faith. Graduates, some really unfair, ugly things can happen to some good people. And you've not yet been hit with some of those things, and some of you have. But if you can keep the spirit and the moment of what you're enjoying today present with you as you go into the world, you're going to remember to find all the great things that by far overwhelm the negative things. I just left London less than 24, 26 hours ago, and I was speaking at a forum about the impact of artificial intelligence on the workspace, on the workforce. on many of you. And the question that I got asked the most often always centered back to fear. Fear about what artificial intelligence will mean to workers, fear about what it will mean to research, just fear, fear, fear. And I shared with them that for every job lost, and this is important where we sit right here in Eastern North Carolina right now, where manufacturing, as it comes back to the United States, is going to come back in a very different form than it left years ago. But I share with them that for every job lost to artificial intelligence, so many more are achieved. Bill Gates employs over 300,000 people in buildings that look like small communities, larger sometimes than the community I mentioned growing up a few minutes ago. Jeff Bezos hires 300 people a week. They're being hired into different methods and cultures of working than we've grown up with here in Eastern North Carolina, but they're being hired. And here's the exciting thing. Many of them are not being hired as employees. They're being hired as independent business owners, as many of you can be. Imagination. Each of these two men imagined something different than they saw. And they used whatever level of education they had to platform that forward. As I stand in front of you right now, I stand as a representative of everything that I've ever been taught and everything I've ever been believed in and fundamentally everything that I could imagine. And I ain't through yet. Y'all see me and you can go on the internet and you can figure out how old I might be because they got all kinds of stuff on the internet, right? By the way, let me give you a tip. Clean your social media presence up. Those of you who will be looking for employment or looking for investors, trust the lady whose job it is to know about jobs. We check you out. And this degree you've got from Wesleyan College will be by far overwhelmed by the presence you have on social media about the fun you had last night. Or tonight. Did you hear what I said? Clean your social media up. Leave behind that time when you could show, I don't know, do y'all do bongs and stuff? Oh, Lord, y'all laughing. You do, and you got your parents out here to see it. Well, they're looking at your back. It wasn't these group laughing real hard, y'all. It was this group. But clean your social media up. Enter the world with a clean, white space. Allow who you are now today to really propel you forward. Imagine all the things you wanted for yourself as you sat through those classes, wrote those papers. Some of y'all showed up late and hoped nobody would notice. Clean all of that up. Enter the world in a fresh new way. Enter the world with a fresh new vision. Enter the world with the fullest imagination as you can. You are going to be asked a lot. Some of you are entering work for the first time, and some of you have come here to gain diplomas that allow you to reinvent the way you work, to propel yourself forward from jobs you've already had. Some of you are going to be a year from now living in homes far away from Rocky Mount, North Carolina, on this beautiful campus. Others of you already have families and homes, and you're paying a lot for them, right? And you're looking at ways to move yourself forward in life for you and the families you've already established. No matter where you go in life and no matter where you are a year from now, remember what you imagined in this moment as you closed your eyes for yourself. Please stay fresh in that. Bring the healthiest attitude you can to whatever you do. You won't always get the choice on how the world treats you, But you'll always have a choice on how you treat the world. And that's the significant difference in how you will succeed in life. Success can be yours. I don't know if any of you follow me online, but I've got something up on YouTube, and it talks about the strangest secret. Go look at it. And the definition of success is not getting a diploma from here. That is a part of your success. The definition of success for you will be your progressive realization of worthy ideals. In the classroom, you've been taught success as a noun. I ask you to break apart that. Break it apart right now. Success is no longer a noun for you. Success is a verb. It is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal. It's happening. It's happening all the time. You've seen it often. You've seen 1 minute somebody's on top. You're reading about them in the newspaper, or you're hearing about them on social media, and the next minute they're on somebody's what happened to them list, where are they now list. You don't reach success. You continue in the process of success. And so the diplomas that you get in a few minutes, yeah, it'll be a few minutes because I'm going to shut up in a minute. The diplomas you get in a few minutes are really the beginning of your success. They're the beginning of a future that you will honor all of the people here and the folks back home by how you imagine life and you bring it to realization. If I share one thing with you today that stays with you, I would pray that it be this. It's something that my husband and I taught our two children. It's something that my 10 siblings and my mother and father taught us all those years ago in Tarboro, North Carolina. I have everything I need to be everything I need to be. Some of you are going to be sitting in interviews. Some of you are going to be asking folks to invest in your dream, looking for angel funders. Don't call me. No, I'm joking. You're going to start to question whether or not that diploma you got is really worth anything. And remember, I told you it's about your attitude sometimes more than your aptitude. So those of you who aren't graduating with that exact 4.0, beef up your attitude, okay? But it's going to be important for you to understand that you do have everything you need to be everything you need to be. Now, I don't have everything I need to be Beyonce. I don't have everything I need to be Mr. Jimmy Johns, leading congregations forward. I have everything I need to be me, to be everything I need to be, and so do you. And this diploma is a seal on that, but it doesn't seal the deal. Please remember, as you take that diploma in hand, as you take that photograph today, put that smile on your face in that photograph that shows all the imagination and promise you hold for yourself. The world is really big right now, but it's also the smallest it's ever been. When I started my company all those years ago, I started, how many of you know what a fax machine is? I started with one fax machine and I thought I was Judy Jetson. And today, I have brick and mortar in 22 countries, but we service over 30 by virtue of technology. The world is as different as you imagine it. My first job in life was working in tobacco. How many of you know what I mean when I say working in tobacco? Oh my goodness, this is North Carolina, and less than a third of you know what I mean, unless y'all not admitting it. It was a very manual process back then. Today, I teach companies how to design, plan, and maintain workforce. Just imagine that. This little girl from Tarboro, North Carolina, whose first job was handing tobacco. Go Google it so you'll know what my experience was. And now, I know it's funny, huh? I know, and now I'm teaching communities across the world how to create work cooperatively with artificial intelligence. How to make sure we maintain the ethics in work for humans as we explore the potential of work through technology. This is big stuff, and you're walking into this. And I pray you walk as proudly as you've earned the right to from this great college. This college was my first experience of higher learning, not just academically, but spiritually, socially. It really fuels my heart to be here today. It mattered to leave London and come here and then get on a plane back out of the country, because those flights that I'm making wouldn't have been possible had I not had a North Carolina Wesleyan in my life, had I not had an experience that taught me that families are born, but they're also enjoined through community. The family of who you are right now. Some of you graduate not knowing each other, but you know the common bond you have of what this college is teaching you. I pray you take that into your future. And I pray that you truly understand what I'm saying when I say that if a little girl like me from Tarboro can lead communities across the world on how to plan for work, create work, and maintain work ethically, then you can achieve what you want as well. There is nothing you can't do aligned with God that you seek. And so I just want you to take one more moment with me, and I want you to think about this as you leave this campus today to go whoop, whoop, whoop it up. I want you to take one more moment with me and just repeat after me. You've heard me say it. I have everything I need to be everything I need to be. Now, in a minute, I'm going to ask you to say it again and say it with conviction. I want to break it down for you. You do have everything you need to be everything you need to be. It's the defining what you need to be that is the big moment. And for many of you, this college experience has helped you to know that. For some of you, it simply platformed you with the education you need to explore that. Leave here with no doubt in your mind nor in your heart that you do have everything you need to be everything you need to be. Be that ethically. Be that compassionately. Be that fully, and be that faithfully and hopefully. Be that all the time. It seems a simple concept sitting here. For some of you, it may even seem, oh, yawn, obviously, obvious. When you leave this campus, you will be faced with so many opportunities. The opportunities that I was faced with as I built my business are what taught me the truth of never compromising who you are personally to become who you wish to be professionally. That's not about bringing your whole self to work. Some of y'all need to leave a little bit of yourself home, okay? It's more about understanding who you are in here and how the classrooms here on campus have taught you to discover that and move that forward with success. And now you know success is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal. So please, please remember as you continue your journey to, yes, look back to those who helped you get here. Continue to ask yourself if what got you here will get you there. Please give back to this college so that others can come and the vision of 2,000 students on this beautiful green lawn become a reality because you were here and you gave back to it. And remember where your purpose is as you seek everything you dream and create realities of those dreams. So, let's stand up and let's share this conversation. Some of y'all need to stand up because it's hot. Give yourself a fan. And let's say it together. I have everything I need to be everything I need to be. Say it with conviction. Say it so the folks in the back can hear it from the back. I have everything I need to be everything I need to be. Yes, you do, and God bless you as you go be that. Thank you very much.
I always tend to follow an amazing and talented speaker, but I'm honored to do so. I will now present the 2017-2018 Exemplary Teacher Award. This year's recipient is always engaged with our students and possess character traits that include kindness, empathy, and patience. He has dedicated his life to his discipline and to North Carolina Wesleyan College. You will always find him present at student, faculty, and staff presentations, as well as other college functions. Students appreciate his calming spirit, especially during final exams. I have personally worked with him over the last 7 years and appreciate his guidance and knowledge. His leadership over the School of Education and Social Science will be missed as he completes his final year as chair this spring. Without further ado, it is my honor to announce that the 2017-2018 Exemplary Teacher Award goes to Dr. J. Quinnen. At the recommendation of the Faculty Personnel Committee, the Provost, the President, and approved by our Board of Trustees, the following two faculty members have been awarded status of Faculty Emeritus. The first is Kathy Winslow. She received her MBA from the University of Florida, her Master of Science in Library Science from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and her Bachelor of Arts from Smith College. She served the college for over 30 years and was our Director of the Library. Dr. Steve Faraby received his PhD from the University of New Mexico, his Master of Arts from the University of New Mexico, and his Bachelor of Arts from the University of Florida. He's also served the college for more than 30 years as a professor of English and also as chair of the School of Humanities. Congratulations.
Thank you again, Ms. Howell-Royd. What an amazing speech. We move now to the conferral of degrees. As I do, I want to offer a brief word of appreciation to our faculty and staff who brought each graduate to this place on this day. And now, with the candidates for the degree, Bachelor of Arts, please stand. On the recommendation of the faculty and by virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of North Carolina Wesleyan College, I hereby confer upon you the degree, Bachelor of Arts, with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. You may be seated. And now, with the candidates for the degree, Bachelor of Science, please stand. On the recommendation of the faculty and by virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of North Carolina Wesleyan College, I hereby confer upon you the degree, Bachelor of Science, with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. You may be seated. And now I'll call upon Dr. Evan Duff, Provost and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs, to present the candidates.
Who's ready to walk the stage? Diamond Columbia Allen, magna cum laude, graduate of the honors program. Brian Delane Austin, summa cum laude. Ashley Nicole Anderson, magna cum laude. Adrian O. Atkinson. Austin Joseph Bain. Kayla Michelle Baker. Chantel Katrina Ball. Adonis Chinule Barkley. Sarah Michelle Boyer, summa cum laude, graduate of the honors program. Candace Renee Bryant Eagles. Tarek Markel Bullock. Alicia Joe Burns. Caitlin Anna Butler, magna cum laude, graduate of the honors program. Zachary Christian Byers. Joshua Wayne Campbell, summa cum laude. Michelle Perkins Cianfera, summa cum laude. Carly Kristen Clary. Kendra Lee Cordero. Ernestine Crocker. William M. Cutler. Alton O'Neill Davis. Raylan Lee Davis. Tiana Midline Elder. Jarrell Tremaine Evans. Stephanie Ann Garrett. Jeffrey N. Geibel, Jr., summa cum laude. Amy Casey Gagne, cum laude. Helen Madison Green. Regina Renee Hampton. Martina Elaine Hardison, transfer honors. Brittany Sue Hensley. Amber Cannon Hill. Peyton Lynn Heiler. Muhammad Bashir Jallo. Michaela Jefferson. Jalen Johnson. Robert Landon Johnson, summa cum laude. Trey A. Jones. Angela Ellis Preston Judah. Malik Reginald Judd. Stephen M. Lassiter. Chantel Lewis. Marcus Jermaine Lewis. Suzette Renee Lewis. Holly Nicole Long, cum laude. Owen Cade Lowry. Makaya Nashe May. Sydney Rose McCall, graduate of the Honors Program. Jennifer Karen Mervin, summa cum laude. Shirley Monk Jones, transfer honors. Courtney Virginia Moss. Raekwonza Keisha Parker. Kiara Yvonne Payne. Joshua Caleb Perry, magna cum laude, graduate of the Honors Program. Monica M. Perry. Hannah Marie Price. Relaine Chanel Rills. Diamond Alexa Ridgway. Joshua L. Siddons, summa cum laude. Katrina Denise Sigmund. Tiffany DeRay Smith, transfer honors. Shelby Nicole Spencer, transfer honors. Stephanie Nicole Stallings, summa cum laude. Shamanika Roche Stanfield, cum laude. Angelique Marie Taylor. Quanisha Lynn Lene Thomas. Shayla Thorne. Holly Shipley Toller, magna cum laude. Ryan Kelly Turner. Jennifer Lee Walker. Deborah Leanne Wall, summa cum laude. Judith Gray Whitfield. Emmanuel Trayvon Williams. Jasmine Renee Williams. Joshua A. Williams, magna cum laude. Okay. Robert Lee Woldridge III, transfer honors. Leticia Renee Worrell. Colton Wayne Young, magna cum laude. Ariana T. Atwell. Latia Victoria Banks. Lonnie Meadows Banks, summa cum laude. Tony Page Barnes, summa cum laude. Austin Hunter Barnhill, magna cum laude. Robert Carl Benson II, summa cum laude. Richard P. Berg. Samari Esmerly Bonilla Torcios. That's her girl. Natalie N. Boykin. Caitlin Elizabeth Brabble, cum laude, graduate of the honors program. Coden Michael Breckenridge. Ardella M. Brooks. Miranda Delane Bryant. Daniela Nicole Burkhart, magna cum laude. Jordan LeCount Butler. Jeremy Robert Carr. Christine Y. Carter, cum laude. Stacy Pierce Cartledge, magna cum laude. Shelby Lynn Cartrett, cum laude. David Chang, summa cum laude. Caitlin Elizabeth Checkin, summa cum laude. Teresa J. Clement. Lauren Catherine Collins, summa cum laude. Candace Jean Confair, summa cum laude. Antonise Javon Cooper. Rakeem Jaquan Cooper. Caleb Tyler Creed, summa cum laude. Tina L. Dancy Pickett. Carolyn Marie Davern, summa cum laude, graduate of the Honors Program. Lucia Dorothy Davids. Ter Lamont Davis. Christy Nicole Dubrow. Marjorie Del Carmen. Rebecca Nell Dement, magna cum laude. Dante Maurice Denning. Justin Lamar Denning. Nilank Shailesh Kumar Desai. Anna Christina Diaz Mares. Ashley Rose Dunn. Jessica Michelle Eason. Christine Lee Edwards. Tamsy Miller Evans, summa cum laude. Joan Arnett Anderson Everett, magna cum laude. Kyle Farkas, cum laude. Anisha Ann Felton. Diamond Leisha Fogg. Goldie M. Ford. Tevin Donald Foster. Nikelia Tesha Freeman. Ashley Nicole Gaines. Christina Katie Genovese, magna cum laude. Marion Clementine Harrison Gibbs. Benjamin Herod Gillen. Tamara Marie Glover, magna cum laude. Savannah Renee Gore, cum laude. Christopher Jerome Green. Jasmine Monique Hall. Brenda C. Hardy. Melissa W. Harkness, summa cum laude. Tracy Brent Harrell. Brittany Dawn Harrelson, summa cum laude. Ishmael Abdul Rauf Harris, magna cum laude. Molly Frances Haviland, magna cum laude. Madison L. Heggie, cum laude. John Christopher Henderson, transfer honors. Thomas Charles Henderson. Olivia Jocelyn Hernandez. Cole Allen Higginbotham. Christopher Higgins, magna cum laude. Taikia Vashan High. Nina Williams Hill. Demetrius Raniel Holder. Latricia Williams Holloway, magna cum laude. Karen Marie Ori. Tara McLemore Howard. Christina Iconics, transfer honors. Victoria Janae Ingram. Nicholas Franklin Ipok, summa cum laude. Justin Navarre Jackson, cum laude. Anthony Joseph Janasek. Brittany Raquel Jenkins. Brenda Carol Jeanette. Jared Thomas Johnson, summa cum laude. Stacy Chanel Johnson. Joshua Nathaniel Jones. Letitia G. Jones. Joy Natasha Jones Brown. Ashley Elizabeth Fox Kemp. Austin Nicholas King, cum laude, graduate of the Honors Program. Jefferson Nathaniel Knight. Kayla Celeste Knox. Lucas Anthony Kuhn, summa cum laude. Samantha Jo Kuntz. James Michael Carnegie. Yuka Kugimaru, summa cum laude. Trevor Lee Lamb. Kayla Marie Laughinghouse. Shannon Diane Lee. Kristen Nicole Lennon, magna cum laude. Danielle Pavoni Lester, magna cum laude. Carolyn Michelle Lindsay, cum laude. Kim Michelle Longpals. Di Giovanni Ron Lugo, cum laude. Ashley Elizabeth Major, magna cum laude. Clarissa Nicole Mangini. Amanda Alexis Mazza, summa cum laude. Jennifer Elaine Mears. Nancy Tennille Meeks. Star Destiny Mitchell. Adrian Maurice Moore. Janelle Elizabeth Blunt Moore, cum laude. Shannon Medlin Mooring, transfer honors. Carlton Earl Morris. Samantha Nicole Morton. Elizabeth Denise Murchison. James Thomas Murray II. Laveria Pritchett Merle, transfer honors. Joseph Ryan Nas, summa cum laude. Caleb Young Naren. Daniel Foy Norman. Helen Denise Page, magna cum laude. Pilar Laverne R. Parks, summa cum laude. Richard Leslie Patton, magna cum laude. Monique Latrice Pendleton. Shanquilla Davana Perry, cum laude. Juanita W. Phillips, cum laude. Nakisha Shanae Phipps. Malin Natalie Potter, summa cum laude. Kamar Naeem Rawls. Julia R. Rebellin, magna cum laude, graduate of the honors program. Brendan Matthew Reeser. Spencer Richardson Jr., magna cum laude. Shantae Kulia Gibbs Rickert. Wara Wakia Ricks. Shem Dalton Ritchie. Alexis Marie Rodriguez. Joel Alexander Roney, transfer honors. Joshua Lee Roney. Matthew Caleb Rose. Quinn Sheehan Ryan. Monica Salazar Reyes, cum laude, graduate of the honors program. Adam Dylan Sell. Michael Sauce. Natoya Michelle Scott. Jimmy Sharp. Alina Y. Sheglova, magna cum laude. Cassandra Ray Sakari, summa cum laude. Carl Sebastian Seek. Tasha Ann Silver. Sarah Faye Fisher Slater, transfer honors. Mark Sokoloff. Florencia Sorrentino, summa cum laude. Amanda Lorraine Spruill. James Edward Stevens. Madison Lee Stewart. Desiree Alexandria Strong. Bianca Danielle Boykin Sutton. Ruth Ann Thomas, magna cum laude. Travis Austin Thompson. Hannah Marie Tolson, magna cum laude. Morgan Ruth Townsend, summa cum laude. Brooke Sisk Tyndall, summa cum laude. Tara Lynn Vell. Cody Allen Valancourt. Garrison Coley Vick. James Setta Wainwright. Michael Allen Wall, magna cum laude. Wendy Richardson Washington, summa cum laude. Taishiba Watson. Anthony Rocco Wazornik, magna cum laude. David Franklin White, graduate of the Honors Program. Shane Robert Wiggins, cum laude. Tracy Blackman Wiggins, cum laude. Andrea Williams. Corey DeMond Williams, Jr. LeVar Jermaine Williams, magna cum laude. Spencer T. Witherspoon, cum laude. Jacqueline L. Worlds. Kelly Ann Wynn. Congratulations.
Well, my name is Emmanuel Williams, and I am the current SGA president for right now until I walk off of this campus. But right now it's so hot out here that my tablet just went down. Technology. But my grandma always say, always prepare what you want to talk about in your heart. So basically, I just want to say to the class of 2018 that this is not just the end, but this is the beginning. It's time that we take this and move forward. Move forward and help somebody else. Many of times I will ask myself, what is the true meaning of life? What does life mean to me? And basically, when I came here to North Carolina Wesleyan College, I was a depressed young man. I was a troubled young man. I made one suicidal attempt. But can I tell y'all why I am so happy right now? Do y'all really want to know why I am so happy? I am happy that I did not end my life, because I am here today to tell you that your life is for the better, that you continue to live, push forward, help somebody else, and I trust and believe you will succeed. Amen. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to thy own understanding, but in all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he will what? That's right, my class. I just want to say to three special friends, one, to Shantoni Grant, thank you for being there for me. My sophomore year, I'm glad I had a chance to mentor you. And then I'm going to have to thank my brother, Jarrell Evans. Jarrell Evans, crossing the first Kappa line. I love you too. And my best friend told me not to do this, but I cannot leave here without telling her that I love you so much. You've been there for me, even though I would tell you to stand right now, but you're so short, everybody won't be able to see you. But she's going to get me later. But I want to say that you stuck by me, and I see you right now. Thank you, Kelly Wynn, for all that you have done for me. I'm so happy that I get to be a part of your wedding, to be the man of honor. Amen. But at the end of the day, I love you. But continue to push forward and continue to give back to this college. I'm going to encourage my class, don't let it end here. We have a job to do. We need to come back to North Carolina Wesleyan College and minister to the young people that are coming in next. We need to give back some kind of way, whether it's money, whether it's your time, whether it's just you coming, you bringing a young person to your job to show them how, where you have basically came from, they can come as well. Love one another. Believe in yourself. Trust in God. And you will succeed.
Thank you, Emmanuel. And also thank you, Dr. Evan Duff. Can you imagine going to bed last night and knowing that you got to wake up this morning and correctly pronounce everyone's first, middle, and last name? That's a lot of pressure. Great job, Dr. Duff. I'm here to present the North Carolina Wesleyan Leadership Award. This award is presented to a student who best exemplifies strong leadership qualities. This award recognizes a student as being especially dedicated to campus and community activities. This student has made outstanding contributions to campus-wide programs and displayed positive leadership in and out of the classroom. The recipient for the inaugural award here in the spring of 2018 was nominated and determined by the President's Cup Algernon Sidney Sullivan Award Committee. Future nominations may come from the faculty, staff, or a member of the administration who does not serve on the selection committee. This year's North Carolina Wesleyan College Leadership Award, and this is no surprise, goes to Emmanuel Williams.
Thank you. Congratulations.
And now for the Algernon Sidney Sullivan Award. Each year, two North Carolina Wesleyan graduates are selected to receive prestigious awards which recognize special achievement. The first that we will recognize is Algernon Sidney Sullivan Award recipient. This award is presented to a senior who best exemplifies excellence in character, leadership, service to the community, and a commitment to spiritual values. This humanitarian award is meant to recognize those who have selflessly given to others or served others in some way. The recipient is chosen by the Honors Awards Committee, composed of the Vice President of Student Affairs and Dean of Students, the Registrar, Chairman of the Faculty, the Honors Program Director, and the Provost and Vice President of Academic Affairs. The 2018 Algernon Sidney Sullivan Award goes to Carolyn Marie Davron. Lastly, the President's Cup Award. The President's Cup Award is presented to a senior who best exhibits those characteristics considered most desirable in a graduate. Of particular importance is the attainment of the highest standards of academic performance as demonstrated by the overall grade point average at North Carolina Wesleyan College. The recipient is also chosen by the Honors Awards Committee. The 2018 President's Cup recipient is Lucas Anthony Coons.
We're almost done. Honorary degrees are conferred on individuals whose lives have characterized remarkable achievements, sustained commitments to the values stated in North Carolina Wesleyan College mission, namely preparing students for professional achievements, lifelong learning, and responsible participation in their communities. There's a common thread of service among the past recipients. Mrs. Janice Bryant Hallward certainly has these same qualities. Therefore, under the recommendation of the Honorary Degree Committee and the approval of the Board of Trustees, it is my privilege to bestow upon Mrs. Janice Bryant Hallward from Tarboro with the degree of Doctor of Science of Humanities and all the rights and privileges thereinto. Thank you, Mrs. Hallward. Very inspirational.
Good morning, President Clark, faculty, Board of Trustee members, and most importantly, graduates and guests. My name is Eddie Moore, and I'm a 2009 graduate of North Carolina Wesleyan College. I'm here today in my capacity as a member of the Alumni Association. As you're well aware of, today is a milestone of achievement in your life. With the support of family, friends, and significant others, you've completed your bachelor's degree, and we, the North Carolina Wesleyan family, are immensely proud of your accomplishments. You came to North Carolina Wesleyan College looking for knowledge and opportunity for a better future for you. Today you enter the world as a college graduate and as future leaders of our society. Woodrow Wilson said, "You're not here merely to make a living. You're here in order to enable the world to live more amply, with greater vision, with a finer spirit of hope and achievement. You're here to enrich the world, and you impoverish yourself if you forget the errand. As the celebration of your accomplishment ends and you launch, relaunch, or even redefine your career and future through your newly gained baccalaureate degree, remember all of the knowledge, skills, relationships, friendships, and experiences you gained through your time at North Carolina Wesleyan College. These have all prepared you to enrich your world and to contribute to your own communities through social and civic engagement. As you embark on your journey through life, remember that you will continue to be a part of North Carolina Wesleyan College's community, and it needs your engagement as well. We have an alumni office that encourages your active participation. As you travel down the road of life, remember to let them know where you are and what you're doing so that we can celebrate your accomplishments as they unfold. Make sure they have good contact information so they can also keep you informed about the things going on here at Wesleyan. Today, you each received a commemorative coin as you crossed the stage. You're among the first classes at North Carolina Wesleyan College to receive these coins, and with you begins a new tradition. Each year, each class will receive their own commemorative coin with a college seal on one side and a picture of a campus landmark on the other. This picture, along with the date, will change annually. The 2018 coin bears the picture of the Serpentine Wall. With the receipt of this coin and completion of your degree requirements, you join a community of over 15,000 Wesleyan alumni. From those graduating today, those who will walk the stage in the fall, or will be attending classes in the coming years, the administration, the faculty, the staff, and all those who graduated before and after us, whether you attended classes here in Rocky Mount or at one of the Aspire campuses, we are North Carolina Wesleyan College. As you leave today, your travels in life may take you a very short distance or possibly thousands of miles away. Whatever the case, I can tell you from experience that a part of you will most certainly remain here. I would just like to remind you of one last thing. The name on your birth certificate generally represents the family that raised you. The name on your degree today represents you and North Carolina Wesleyan College. From this day forward, represent them all with honor, integrity, and perseverance. On behalf of the Wesleyan alumni community, it is my great honor and pleasure to welcome each of you as members of the North Carolina Wesleyan College Alumni Association. Now please join me as we transfer our tassels from right to left. Welcome to your Alumni Association. Now if everyone will stand and sing the alma mater in the back of your program.
Be seated very briefly. Congratulations and best wishes again to our graduates. You make us all proud. We wish each of you the very best in the coming years. I urge you to keep in touch with your alma mater. Please do not be a stranger here. You're part of the Wesleyan family forever. Let me close by quoting John Quincy Adams. If your actions inspire others to dream more, learn more, do more, and become more, you are a leader. Please all stand for the receiving of the colors, and afterwards, our chaplain, Reverend Dr. Barry Drum, will offer the benediction. Thank you very much.
Let us pray. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. I ask that all of you in the audience stand and remain at your seat until those in the procession have left the commencement area and the event staff releases the guest. Then you may meet your graduates by the patio near the bookstore, which is out to my right.